Welcome. Thank you very much for coming. Welcome to the first day of the first ever Feminist Festival at Loyola University New Orleans. My name is, if you don't know me, I'm Patricia Boyette, and I'm the director of the Women's Resource Center. And this whole festival is sponsored by the Women's Resource Center and the Women's Studies Committee. And this particular panel is also sponsored by the incredible Music Industry Program. So I want to thank you very much for helping us pull this together and get these amazing guests. I want to just throw out a few thank yous because you can't pull a festival together without a lot of people working on it. A quick, brief talk about the purpose of the festival, and then we'll start our program. But first, I want to thank the amazing Professor Kate Duncan, who conceived of this panel. She was the one that came to me and conceived of this panel, and then we worked with Reed Wick, who is here somewhere. Thank you very much from Grammy U, and helped us greatly pulling wonderful guests together. Kate Duncan's going to introduce our wonderful guests in more detail, but I just want to throw out a thank you to all of them for being here. Tank and the Bangas in the middle, from Tank Ball from Tank and the Bangas, Cheryl Banks, and Lily Kieber, right? Did I say it right? And she'll give you more of their bios in a second. I also want to thank my amazing student staff at the Women's Resource Center. A couple are here tonight, Bridget O'Connor in the back, and Denise Seedy, who did the wonderful programs, and Courtney Baker over here, too. So thank you all very much. I also wanted to thank the Women's Studies co-chairs, Valerie Gortzen and Shermiko Melanson, the Diversity Committee, because they gave us some grants to fund some of this. And I also want to, of course, thank the President's Office, the Provost's Office, for the support of the festival. I just want to say just briefly why we're doing this. What's the purpose of a feminist festival in the 21st century? You often get, you know, I hear sometimes that we don't need feminism anymore. And certainly we have come a very long way. So part of that, of holding the festival, is to celebrate how far we have indeed come. I mean, considering 96 years ago, women couldn't even vote, and today we have a viable, you know, woman running for president, that's incredible, right? But it's because women struggled and pulled together and had great allies and many men and, you know, worked through several different movements that women have come so far, that women are shakers and movers in every major industry today. They are in political rotundas, they're in military battlefields, they're in, you know, CEO boardrooms, and they're in music and the arts. And to me, one of the greatest, you know, joys in the world and one of the greatest influences in the world is the arts. That is heavily influenced in our society, and that's one of the reasons we wanted to do this panel, Pioneering Women in the Music Industry. The festival is also to celebrate the great diversity of feminism. This fourth wave of feminism, I'm thinking, is going to be the best one, because in previous, you know, movements, there's often been division and, you know, that broke apart the movement sometimes. It is my deep belief that to be a feminist, you must believe in the equality of every person. Women represent every race, every ethnicity, every religion, every culture, every nationality, every sexual orientation. And now we are even broadening the movement further because we have new understandings of gender identity. So this fourth wave of feminism is the biggest umbrella we've had in feminism yet. And also, I've always been very grateful to men who have joined the movement as allies, and I think it's really exciting to see how many men, particularly a lot of, you know, musicians and celebrities, who are coming out and boldly saying, yes, I am a feminist. So I think there's a lot of that to celebrate. I think Loyola is a perfect place to do a feminist festival because our mission is devoted to social justice and to fighting for the oppressed and seeking a more just world. So I'm very excited to have this festival. I'm super excited for this event. I've had the great privilege of meeting these wonderful women, and I look forward to learning more about them. But I do want to introduce first one of our great pioneers in music industry right here, Kate Duncan. many of you know her very well, but for those of you that don't, she brings a wide range of musical experience to her courses and ensembles here at the Music Industry Program. She has spent the last 10 years as an educator and a performer in nearly every genre, from opera to pop to jazz and funk. She is also a vocal jazz arranger, lecturer, and clinician for various groups across the country, and has spent many years as a director for a school of music in Pennsylvania. In addition to teaching courses and ensembles, she continues to pursue her performance and writing and arranging career here in the greater New Orleans area. Her duties on campus reside in the popular and commercial music degree program and include vocal ensembles, ensemble direction, private voice study, and musicianship theory courses. She also serves as an advisor to Full Tilt Event Productions, a student-run entrepreneurial group. So you can tell Professor Duncan is very busy, and I have seen her here very many late nights, and I know she works long hours, and she's a wonderful colleague and a wonderful person to work with. So without further ado, I want to turn the program over to Professor Kate Duncan.
Thank you. I so appreciate the opportunity that Patricia has given the music industry and women and their role in the music industry as part of this festival. It's really cool to be the kickoff, one of the kickoff events for the first day. And it is something that is close to my heart. It has always just been about equality for me, and for me to walk into a room and be able to say, these are my ideas, they're on par with yours, let's see what we can make of them. And I have three amazing women to my right that I think are on the same page with that. So without further ado, I also have to say that today I was writing my notes down, and as I wrote, my eyes kept getting bigger and bigger because these women are powerhouses. They have done so many incredible things, and I am super honored to be sharing a stage with them and being able to have a conversation about... about, no, you guys are, you're pretty kick-ass, so yeah, I'm very excited. I want to start with Ms. Cheryl Banks. She is an artist manager by trade, and she has founded her own company, JVU Entertainment, which has done incredible, incredible things. She has worked with the folks in under Master P's label. She has also worked with Timbaland's label, mostly music. That was all so long ago, and since, you have done outrageously cool things.
Thank you.
So I wrote all of these down because I couldn't handle it. So she manages J. Rock Harmon and King Logan, who were on an Omarion track in the early 2000s. Icebox?
Yeah, that was the first track.
Yeah. They also work with Carrie Hilson too. So some big names for the early 2000s. Mm-hmm. And then you kind of did some more things that maybe this audience would know. 2020 Experience.
Yeah, we did the
Justin
entire
Timberlake.
2020 album.
Yeah.
Yeah. Beyonce, Jay-Z, Magna Carta.
Yeah, the Magna Carta. Blurred Lines, Lil Robin Thicke in there too. And you have just been on the road, killing it, right?
Yeah, just a little.
Just a little bit, yeah. And the thing that I got kind of professionally stalking you this week, the thing that I kept seeing was that you really like making connections between the art and the way the art's going to happen.
Yes.
And it seemed like that was really something that came out, that passion came out in all of your projects and in all of the connections across your career. So I just love that, and I appreciated that so much. And that I wanted to ask you, just where does that come from, and how did you even kind of develop that skill?
Well, I think I actually started out in music as an artist, and I knew at some point I realized, okay, clearly I don't want to sing. This is not what I want to do. And I loved the business.
Sure.
And I loved helping people find their true inner talent. And in that, I kind of fell in love with it, and it just took off. And it's all men, usually, that I'm working with and helping them find their inner talent. But it's incredible. Like, I really, really enjoy, like, helping artists find their niche. Because
really,
it's very important, like, in the industry, to know your niche is very important. So it's I'm very passionate.
Well, that's interesting. I think that we have the music industry degree program here, and it's a Bachelor of Science, and a lot of our students are interested in publishing, artist management, sync licensing, all of those things behind the scenes. And they forget that they are in a helping profession as well.
Yes.
You know, nurses and educators, they get all the stars and glory for being helpers. But I really do agree with you that there is that helping component to linking people together and helping to develop their talent and to display that to their best capacity.
Yes, it is.
So you hit on a topic, and I want to ask. The music industry, it is no secret that the hip-hop world, R&B world, is heavily male-dominated, especially the behind-the-scenes, people-who-make-it-happen type folks. Talk to me about how you've navigated that and how you've kind of steered your way through to be so successful.
Well, funny, I used to think about it, and then I'm so used to it now, like I kind of stopped thinking about it. But when I spoke with you on the phone the other day, I stopped to think and I was like, wow. Like, I literally work with all men.
Yeah.
And it's fairly easy. I have to be patient sometimes. I can't be too aggressive because when I'm too aggressive, it's like, oh, it's that time of the month. Yeah, I sometimes have to watch my approach. But it's easy. Like the guys like she said, they're allies, truly. Mm-hmm. It's not difficult at all. I wish I had more women around working with me. Usually the women that come around are like the wives, assistants.
Sure.
But it's easy. It's fairly easy working with. I get to work with female artists all the time, and you hear the guys make comments and. But it's interesting, and I enjoy it. It's not really a hard task at this point. You kind of get used to it, and you know how to deal with it. Yeah. You know when you walk in the room, you know when to kind of lay low and when to bark.
Yeah.
So I guess I've kind of mastered that at this point. So it's really cool.
Yeah.
It's cool.
That's good. That's good to hear.
Yeah.
I had a meeting with a couple of my seniors, female seniors, and they were talking just about things that they experienced in the studio and different navigational pieces mm-hmm. when working mm-hmm. with their colleagues. Mm-hmm. And it was so interesting. They were mentioning this to their male friends, and it was a glaze over. The male friends, you deal with that? You hear that? They talk to you like that? And for a group of women to get together and kind of say, like, this is how it is. And we, you know, kind of pave away all of that crap that we have to deal with and smooth it over into something nice, like a great working environment.
Yes.
It really kind of opened my eyes. That was really the first time that I thought about having you guys here was mm-hmm. to have these voices say these things that we all kind of work through and experience mm-hmm. In unison that you don't often get to hear about. And I'm glad that working with these guys and you finding that equality and that leveled out balance is easier now.
Yes, it is a lot easier at this point. It wasn't always easy,
yeah.
But now it is a lot easier.
Yeah.
I mean, 10 years mm-hmm. in, I've kind of developed relationships with each guy I work with, and mm-hmm. it's pretty easy. Sometimes, you know, like, especially when I'm bringing, like, new artists in, certain women, I have to say, okay, hold up, that's inappropriate. But it's easy. They get it, you know, and yeah. Especially in 2016, they understand.
Yeah.
So it's pretty easy now.
Excellent.
Yeah.
I love that. All right, so I'm coming back to that.
Okay.
I'm gonna move on to my second guest. I want to introduce Lily Kieber. She's an incredible documentarian, and her subjects and her topics are something that just get me super jacked about what she does in her art. The latest project that I learned about tonight that she was involved in, she was a piece in the Formation video from Beyonce, and that is super, super awesome. So I wanted to mention that first. But her big movies were Bayou Maharaja, and that's a James Booker film. For those of you who don't know James Booker, get to know James Booker. He's wild, wild cat. And I don't know, the eye patch alone that he continually wore and was his piece of recognizable attire makes him super legit. Yeah, we've got a picture. I stole this off your website. I'm sorry. It will never be used for rights purposes ever, but I had to show you guys because for those of you who don't know James Booker, he's wild. He taught literally everybody under the sun how to play piano like a cool person. He taught, you know, I heard that Harry Connick was allowed to go over there when he was 6 years old, which some decision-making skills by the parents I don't know about, but he taught true musicians how to bring out their musicality, and Lily's film is incredible. So if you have not yet seen it, I do really, really encourage you to see it. It is as much about the man and the music as it is about his way in the industry. And I think, like us talking here about a new momentum, I think he was part of another momentum that he really helped to solidify here in New Orleans and as a musician and get all of that, those balls rolling that we take for granted so easily now. So it's a wonderful film. The latest film that I'm almost somehow more excited about, called Buck Jumping, is about the New Orleans tradition of dancing and street music and all of the beat behind these New Orleans musical traditions. I do want to show a trailer, if we can, of that. It's cool.
It's my turn to touch the streets. And I'ma dance. Some gon' love, some gon' hate. As long as they respect. Let's get it!
More than just like the music and a couple of steps. It's an energy, it's a vibe, and it's a connection. It's a connection, I'm telling you, you can feel it. You can really feel it.
What you shaking it for? What you twerking it for? What you dropping it for? What you booty popping it for?
I'm gone. It can't keep up with me. They're like, how you do that? Bah, 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 bah.
That's awesome. Yeah. Give you a hand for that. I told you, right? Yeah, that is incredible.
Yeah, now so, I just gotta finish it.
Yeah. What's the intended release date? Is there one yet? No, okay. We're still working on it. That's okay.
I'm in the fundraising stage, so. And I will be.
Yeah.
For the next, anyway, yeah.
Solicitations, by the way. On top of being an incredible filmmaker, on top of being obviously really connected to the music here, the music industry, what struck me most about this particular film, and even the James Booker material, you infiltrated a lot of really, really kind of sacred moments and community type things to document. And not only are you a woman walking in with a camera and a boom mic to do that, but you're kind of working through what people don't realize is a year-round community that, you know, Super Sundays, whatever's in July, August, September, October, it's not just Mardi Gras, but you're walking in and kind of infiltrating that. So talk to me about what that was like and how you, one, you know, ingratiated yourself into these incredibly intimate, wonderful moments and shots.
Well, for one, I don't walk in with a camera. So with Buck Jumping, it's a profile of New Orleans through six or seven communities and the style of dance of each of those communities. So for example, with Second Line, you know, might start with the visuals of the Second Line, get into what that is. But ultimately, it's more about the social club who hosts the Second Line, in this case, nine times. And then we examine the role and the function, or how Nine Times functions in their community. So not only did they put on the community, the dance, but they also buy school supplies for kids and, you know, make sure that, you know, like provide after school and, you know, look after the whole community because it is such an underserved community. So sort of people have to step up and do that on their own. That's just one example. So that second line, we have church styles, trail rides, which is the one non-New Orleans storyline. It was out in Lake Charles. Indians. I'm making this film and I can't remember what it's like.
I think, did you mention Bounce? Do you have some Bounce in there? Yeah.
You know, and then another. Oh, and Drag. There you go. So it's sort of like these different communities, but hopefully by the time we get around, you know, like through the whole film, it becomes a quilt. There's got to be a better way to say that. but it'll be a profile of New Orleans and sort of the way that I've gotten to know New Orleans, you know, these like communities that I don't often see depicted on the big screen.
Yeah. Which I think that's a really important thing that you've kind of tapped into there to represent these things that are so thickly woven in those communities and with those people. That's every weekend, you know, whether it's making the uniforms, whether it's picking out the next band that's going to rehearse, all of that. And you've done such a keen job, I think, just from the trailer of getting that taste.
And I guess your question was, how do I connect with those communities?
Yeah.
Mostly by hanging out.
Cool.
I mean, truly, just, you know, going to see, you know, TBC on Wednesday nights and then, you know, being hanging out at Celebration, you get to know, well, for one, I got to know TBC and then ended up making a film about them over the summer, but then also got to know the Pigeontown Steppers, or people from the Pigeontown Steppers, or people from Nine Times. So just sort of like hanging out and being me and talking and, you know, getting to know them and their story first, and then, you know, asking if I could come with a camera or follow them. Luckily, New Orleanians are the least shy people on the planet. So I was always like, yeah, of course, come on, bring your whole crew, stay for lunch. And it's like, you know, I'm like, oh God, put your clothes back on, you know? Like,
it's not that kind of movie.
Well, like for Nine Times, when they're getting ready, it's like talking about working with dudes. We walk in and, like, you know, I'll shoot weddings for cash. And it sort of had that feeling of like a wedding, like everyone's getting ready, but walk in and, you know, I had two women on my crew and two men. And we walk in and just like all these naked dudes. And it's just like we're invisible. Like they don't, I mean, they could care less about us. They're like, hey, what you at? Like, you know, like, look at the nine that's on my underwear. I'm like, that's awesome. James, I'm going to let you shoot that. But actually, it was funny because later it's like the men were getting ready in one room and the women were getting ready in another one. So for one, I'm there with the men. And again, it's like he just doesn't care that I'm a filmmaker. Just at that point, again, I'm just like wallpaper. They've forgotten about me. But he's like, oh, here, you know how to tie a bow tie?
Of course. Lend a helping hand.
Well, I'm not really from New Orleans. It's like, if I was from New Orleans, I probably would know how to tie a bow tie. But like, whatever, I went and figured it out. And then we went over to the women's. And as they walk in, they're like, oh, James, there you are. James, our boom guy. And they're like, everything had to stop so that he could show them all how to tie a tie. It's like, good thing we're here right now.
Yeah.
But that's also sort of, you know, it's like filming does stop, you know, because at those points, you know, you become friends and you become support. And, you know, that's more important or as important as, you know, filming. And I guess that's sort of the thing is I want people to feel that they own the films as much as I do, which makes it a harder process. Like, it's certainly, I think, easier to just be, you know, a dictator. But I don't know. That's not the kind of film I do.
Yeah, well, I'm hearing a theme from Cheryl's comments of, you know, finding that working balance and kind of inclusion. And I want to talk about that a little bit later as far as what Patricia's remarks were regarding feminism. But I love that. And it's kind of an interesting role that you play, too, where you said the word wallpaper a minute ago. You, in a way, are this, you know, walking in lady, artistic vision. You've got all of this down in your head. And yet you do have to take a step back and become the ancillary piece to that moment. And I think that that's kind of probably an interesting balance to strike.
Well, I'm definitely not. I mean, it's a really big camera, for one.
So they can see you coming.
Lord, especially going to the second lines. Like, now I'll just be like standing in a bar and someone walking, it's camera lady, where's your camera? God. I'm like, it's, I'm just drinking. it's not actually always attached to me.
Yeah.
I know, but it's kind of cute, you know?
Yeah, for sure. You have a reputation, camera lady. Oof. I like that.
but I think also in terms of, I mean, the film world is also overwhelmingly male-dominated.
Absolutely.
And I feel, I mean, for one, in a way, I think it kind of works because, you know, sort of like, you know, in my position, women are less threatening, you know, so sort of like I feel that people will open up or they're like more willing for me to come in with a camera because maybe like as a woman, I'm less suspicious. They're foolish for that, but, and I think that also, I don't know, for me, with my crew, I always feel like it's very much like a family, you know? I make sure that, or I want to make sure that the people behind the camera are as, you know, reflective of the community as possible, you know? I mean, for one, I'm not from New Orleans, so it's very important to me to, like, always have as many people from New Orleans mm-hmm. here to sort of check me, you know? Yeah. I mean, we all have a standing rule, like, no crawfish, no fleur-de-lis, no streetcars, you know? you know, but also just sort of, like, you know, to make sure that I'm not, like whatever, missing subtleties.
Sure.
But I think also I was a bartender for years, and that was the best training for being a filmmaker, of just like the dudes hitting on you constantly and just like learning how to politely like put them down, make fun of them, but in a way that doesn't hurt their ego too bad, but just like, no, seriously, like, no, not gonna happen. You know, just like you're gonna encounter it, but luckily from my dad I inherited the like his smartassness.
Excellent.
Yeah, so that's, I feel like, yeah, you can't avoid it, but just learning how to deal with it.
Yeah, I agree with that. Excellent. Well, I have more questions on that, too.
It was a very rambly answer, I'm sorry.
It was great.
You probably fell asleep twice in it.
So I want to introduce, last but not least, my third guest, Taviana Ball, better known as Tank.
Yay.
Oh, Tank and the Bangas. So excited.
This is exciting.
I'll tell you what. Spoken word, really cool, rhythmic R&B, soul. I gotta say that I love Walmart the most. Oh my God, like that song. That song hit way before we were even thinking about this. And I was so excited. I was like, Walmart, yes.
That's so cool. Wow. No, it's so crazy because I'm sitting up here, but I, as I read the profiles of the ladies, I feel so special, just honestly, not just as myself, but just being next to them. That, you know how dope it was to see that video and see somebody you know?
I know, right?
You know? That's how you know that you really didn't went into the heart of this thing. And 2020, what? That was one of the best albums ever, so I'm feeling quite special.
Well, you are special.
Okay.
I'm so grateful for all three of you, but Tank, you've been band leading. You've been killing it with this band for so long and it's such amazing accomplishments. I'm blown away reading all the reviews, all of the nominations, all of that, all of the spots you play. It's amazing. And to have a woman in the front of a band, you don't realize, I love the history of specifically jazz music, and you don't realize unless you are doing it where that person has come from. There were sequins dresses and the instrumentalists jeering at jazz singers, the Billie Holidays, the Ellas, because they got all the attention and the instrumentalists were always bitter about it because they're in the front and they don't know anything about music. They just sing pretty like a bird and leave the stage. But to have a woman that is integrating all this theatrical beauty to performances and creating these moments that are just like community-based with your, I love bands that interact equally together and move around and all of that. And to see a woman leading in that way, strongly like that, man, that's something, girl. Like,
thank you.
That's awesome. So.
And those boys are no joke, you know? the greatest part is that I have these positive dudes, you know, they're really Bob Marley laid back-ish type dudes. But the interesting thing about them is when one of them is wrong, they will all be on each other's side, even though they know they're wrong. And that's the times when I feel like I have breasts, you know? Those are the moments when I'm like, but you know he wrong. And then he'll walk out the room with somebody and they'll be like, yo, he crazy. All right.
So you're just standing there kind of in the corner figuring out
They give me the stage to shine on. Definitely, if anything, I'm the person that wants people to know who they are because they have no problem in letting me be that person, you know, that like I'm truly the tank.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Well, it comes across. It really is evident watching live performances, especially. I've seen a couple. And it, like I said, it's inclusion. And everybody's playing their equal part with their particular strength, whatever that is. Yours is, you know, weaving those gorgeous words together.
And I thought you were about to say weave. What?
Creating those.
You're right. Yes.
You know, creating those lyrical moments.
Oh, thank you.
And there's, you know, individually with their independent instrumental talents, just creating this thing that is all of these layers together as this cohesive unit. If it's cool with you, I kind of want to show the drummers video.
Oh my God, sure.
Awesome.
You
got it? Can we cue that up? So this is drummers, and I need to say that I agree with the message of this particular. Well, it's true.
This song is about drummers.
Everything was easier when you act like you were mature. Your music really mattered if the girls were not important. Now everybody knows who you are. Got a brand new fancy, stupid catty blue car. Well, who was right there with you at the bus stop? I'll stop when the checks start rolling in, royalties and whatnot. Helped you write a song about the flowers. I was shocking it, original the album. How come? Who was I to you? Was I just a very long day? Did I last too long? How could you throw the day away? Ridiculous experience. Never trust a drummer cause the beat keeps going. Now you're on the road acting silly. Instagramming, taking pictures, signing titties. Oh. Is she playing with your stick? Are you playing with your sticks? Do you know how this gets when every picky post gets hits? I'm exhausted, exasperated. Scrolling through your pics like some stalky girl you dated. And my ex-boyfriend is so famous. I'ma write a song about it cause I'm jealous. Cause I'm the only one who knows your secrets and your lyrics. If I follow my consensus, I will copyright the sentence. That's true for infringement.
You can think of.
Man, I can't believe you got away and made your way with my songs. Who was I to you? Was I just a very long day? Did I last too long? How could you throw the day away? One thing I have learned from this ridiculous experience, never trust a drummer because the beat keeps going on.
Yeah, that's excellent. It's so cool to
I never
hear.
Never saw it that big before.
It's so cool to kind of pick apart the lyrics and hear all of the things that you're actually saying. I mentioned Walmart, and in this video, the cohesiveness there is awareness. You know, I kept hearing this woman's voice who was so aware of her surroundings and asking for other people to be so aware of their surroundings, whether that's another person or their place in the world. And I think that kind of travels across a lot of your tunes, and I love that. Have you always been this person, this champion of awareness, or were there experiences in your life that kind of brought that out? Is that a deep question right now?
A champion of awareness.
I keep hearing it.
Something that I've been, I've been the type of person that's always been in touch with their emotions. I'll say that. Someone that's always been very expressive about them, whether it was about myself or someone else. I would write poems as a little girl, poems that had nothing to do with me. But I would just, I kind of just had a lot of empathy for people, especially women in situations. I hated to see women go through things. You know, even whether it be my sister's friends, because, you know, I was the youngest sister, or even my mom, you know, see her to go through a lot of things with my stepfather. I want women, not even women, people, but since we're on a feminist panel, women to know, gotta put that in there, how absolutely special and incredible they are, and that your power truly lies in the fact that there is no one like you. No one literally thinks your thoughts. No one has your fingers. I think that's amazing. And the moment that you realize that no one is like you, the more comfortable you can become with yourself and sharing yourself. And that's in your career and especially in love. I'm very big on telling someone how you feel, just like in one of my favorite songs that I wrote, which is Oh Heart, is that you just don't know what you're gonna be in the next lifetime. You don't know what God will make you. You know, you could be a wind chime. He could be a toilet bowl seat, you know? So, but like right now I'm here and you're here and I like you. So let's do something about it. So I would love to write about feelings.
Yeah.
I'm very, feeling it's, person.
And you do it beautifully. So I love that approach. And, you know, pulling those experiences of others, I think, all of you have said that in a unique way, infiltrating those communities in such an inclusive way, and I'm part of you, and tell me your story. Pulling your sister's friend's stories out into your poetry and connecting those artists and then pulling those pieces and those talents out of them. And I think that, you know, I kind of want to clap for all three of you guys, because
y'all are cool.
No, I mean, these are amazing things, and it's all inclusive, and all of you have said that finding your way, finding the individual and the merit in that is really what the key is. And I loved what Patricia said earlier, was that, you know, some people say that we don't need feminism anymore. And I think that feminism, the F word, is it gets a bad rap because of the prior permutations of it. But now it really is something that is everybody equal, and all of us kind of bringing our talents to create a larger whole. I'm lucky to work with 13 feminists, all of which are male. I'm in a department that is all guys and then me. And I'm lucky that everyone brings their specific gifts to the table and says, this is what I can offer, what can we make of it, and what can I combine with what you offer to do something bigger. And I think that that's where we're headed, to do bigger things in our industries and with art, and to make an impact, because all three of you are doing that every day, and so many other women and men in the industries, film and music, are aspiring to do that, to create that bigger whole, and I love that. So I want to ask each one of you, what does the F word mean to you?
Oh, wow.
Feminism.
Here, I'll throw it to you.
That's fun. The crazy thing is, when I think about the word feminism, I really do honestly think of two different struggles that women have gone through, especially being a woman of color. It's been a completely different struggle than what your ancestors have gone through. Yeah. You know, and I'm not just talking about slavery. I'm talking about your right to vote came a little different before mine, you know? And Sarah Bartman, you know, and all these, and Nina Simone, and all these women that had to go through completely different struggle. Even though a struggle is a struggle, just period, but they were different, you know? They were different. But at the end of the day, as far as this day, it's a vagina. And we all have them. And we all have periods. And that unique design makes us all women. And that's my starting point, and that's my end point.
Yeah.
You know?
All right. I like it. For Cheryl.
Cheryl wants to go next. After that.
You want to go next?
I can't even follow. I don't even know.
Did she steal your answer?
She did.
You want to use the vagina?
I was in a vagina monologue. You know, I'm into it.
We'll let you take it. We'll let you take it.
My great-grandmother was a suffragette, so I grew up with the stories of, like, you know, how much they had, you know, like, she had gone out, like, totally embarrassing, you know, the entire family, this is in the South, you know, but, like, fought for what was right. And, you know, my mom, I grew up, I'm the youngest, but my sisters are much, much older, so I grew up, you know, just me and my mom, and watching her struggle, but, like, I mean, she has a PhD, but, you know, we were in poverty, but, and she had, ended up being a park ranger, so she carried a gun. So it's like, whoa, my dear, sweet little Southern mom, like, got a gun. But that was, like, how I was raised, and it was normal. So I think watching her struggle was really, really hard for me, but saying that it like wasn't a big deal because it was just like what you had to do, and that like, you know, she very much modeled that for us, you know, that it's like you don't, you know, you can rely on people, but ultimately it's up to you to make the right decision, you know, for the next generation. And I think that she constantly always made the best decision, even if it wasn't right for her at the time, knowing that she had three daughters, you know, to make our world better. So I think I very much grew up not seeing that it was easy, but seeing that you have to fight the fight. Yeah. And I think I'm also very lucky that, I am getting around to answering your question. I think I'm also very lucky that my parents, you know, with all three of us, were just like, go do whatever you want to do and just do it well, you know? So there was never, you know, like, there was never like, you know, if you want to get married and have kids, awesome. But, you know, it's like, for me, they're always like, oh, she's going to be an artist. Like, she's never going to have a real job now. It was like obvious. But it was also, you know, I've also always known how lucky I am to be in this generation that I, you know, can get away with not having a real job, whatever. I work. I don't clock in, but that means I never clock out, too.
Right.
I can't wait to see what my inbox looks like. But, so for me, feminism has always meant equality. And that it's equality across everything, that it's gender equality, that it's racial equality, that it's, you know, sexual orientation equality, that you don't discriminate and that you help out people as you can. And that, you know, that's not the world that we live in, but that should be the world that we all strive for at all times.
Yeah, I love that. Excellent.
I told you I was getting around to answering it.
I like it.
Just took a minute.
Completely stole my answer. Like, I thought she took it, but she really took it. Because I was going to say equality. So she basically took, I guess in understanding, my brother, I'm the youngest. I have three brothers. And they kind of, in hindsight, I'm really grateful because they made me kind of tough. So I'm far from sensitive. Like, it's a lot of things that most women that come around can't take that I can take. Mm-hmm. But he always, he just said to me, like, don't be fooled. He said, don't be ignorant. We're still not equal, but we're getting there, and it's a lot better. And that's the truth. It is so much better, but we still have a long way to go.
Yeah.
You know, and like Tank said, it is even the separation between, say, your struggle and my struggle, but it's definitely all about equality.
Absolutely.
And the struggle to be equal. It's obvious we've come a long way. We have Hillary running for president, and she's a serious candidate. It's not just a joke.
Yeah.
But it's equality. She hit it on the nail. It's all about equality.
Yeah.
But I'm so sorry. I just want to say, and the funny thing about letting you know that this race is truly still not won is that we have a serious candidate, and we have Trump, who's taken seriously because he is a man.
Exactly, because he's a man.
You know? Yeah. Like, he is taken seriously.
He's taken seriously.
And you know, you have people looking at him like, oh, good. What Trump got to say? What are you talking about this time?
Right.
You know, and that's kind of crazy.
And let her say one of those crazy things that he says.
She can.
She wouldn't get away with it. They would nail her right to that cross. And I think that's the thing that I have always kind of struggled to see is that, you know, you mentioned the suffragettes. They treated them like hell.
Mm.
They beat them in the streets. The struggle of women, they were treated like just awful, lower than human people. But then we also need to be perfect. You know, that expectation of society too, that we are meant to apparently take as much of a beating as possible, but then also be as shiny and chipper and all of that as we possibly can be, and let us have one bad day.
Oh, no.
You're on your period.
Yeah.
Well, we're perfect.
Exactly. Right?
We're perfect when we shut up. I mean, if you open your mouth, something's going to get fucked up. Just like, so.
And it's funny because, like, in entertainment, like, I'm just starting to think about, like, incidents. Like, let me think of some feminist. One of my artists, Giovanna, I've worked with several new artists, and when it's a guy, it's, oh, he's so talented, let me hear his music. But when it's a girl, it's, how does she look?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, are we serious?
Yeah.
She's talented.
Mm-hmm.
But still, today, it's the number one question. Any label, any producer, how does she look?
I couldn't believe when we interviewed Mia X. You know, it's like we had the interview about dance, and then afterwards, you know, like, we're just sitting around talking, and like, I can't help but just keep interviewing, so we just kept rolling, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And she was talking, even, I mean, it's Mia X, mm-hmm. you know. And she's saying, like right away, you know, what an exception she was. You know, she was too dark, she was too fat, she was, you know, like, she was never, you know, like all the other girls, they were trying to like get them in this tiny, tiny. But I think almost in a way it helped because she, you know, she always knew she wanted to write. Mm-hmm. She always knew that like her rhymes was gonna get her there, and sort of because she was a mom already, you know, it's like, and she didn't fit that physical stereotype, right, that it, she had to be taken seriously for her lyrics.
Yes.
And I was just like, but also I couldn't believe how, I mean, it's not news to her, mm-hmm, you know, it's like she's had to live with this for a minute.
Right.
But I couldn't believe, it's like, but it's BX. And that was just like,
is
the way it was for her.
And it's still like that today, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So that's, mm-hmm, one of those things where I have to think, like, we're definitely still trying to break through this.
Yeah.
Especially being Southern. Shoot, mm-hmm, I'm a wild girl on stage. You know, I feel so free when my hair is its nappiest and my clothes are and my clothes are their brightest. Yeah. You know, and my energy is up. I feel so beautiful. But yet, you know, my sisters will still tell me, you know, you're gonna have to tone that down if you wanna get married. Mm-hmm. You know, men don't like all that. You're gonna tone, mm-hmm, it down. And I said, but you know, I've been loved as I am before, and once, mm-hmm, you've been loved as you are, you really can't go back.
There's no
going
back.
That's amazing.
You know?
Yeah. No, to find those partners in business, love, and friendship, I think that's what pushes you through when somebody sees you as just all of your amazing qualities, and maybe they see those terrible qualities too, and accept those and love those as well. I was going to kind of ask all of you, what pushes you through? Because that, for me, that's what pushes me through, is people appreciating individual qualities about each other, and just, you do what you do, you work your best work, and that's what pushes me day to day to be that person.
But before we get to that,
you are wild. I like you.
Meanwhile, I come from you.
I actually differ from you.
Right. But I think that it also speaks to, I feel that like with men, you know, there's more of like your professional persona, and then like what you do in your off time. And I feel like with women, it bleeds over so much more of that, like who you are on stage, you know, your sisters are saying is gonna like, you know, affect your personal life, you know, mm-hmm, that like a potential husband's not gonna like that because of what he sees on stage. And I feel like all the time we have to be, you know, like conduct ourselves in a certain way, you know, it's like, I mean, see, you know, like a man can go out, I mean, we're in New Orleans, and go out and get trashed, you know, and like the next day he's at work, no one thinks twice about it. But I feel like just the tongues wag so much about more with women. I think that, you know, to be professional and to be in this city, I feel like the women have to, you have to always be on guard. You always have to think of who you are in that setting,
always,
you know, and that I just don't think that men in similar roles have to deal with that.
No. I don't think so either.
So.
Yeah, and that's, I think that struggle that's still happening. I agree with that 100%.
It's like we're talking about like workplace professionalism, and that's hard enough, but I think that it bleeds over so much into...
In the club, we have to maintain.
You can't go to the club and get too wild.
No.
You're like, girl, look...
Right, right.
You know, we can't do that. Right. Meanwhile, you could Chris Brown it. They're drinking in the club. They, you know what I'm saying? But a woman... they're gonna look at you completely different.
Yep, mm-hmm, absolutely. You know? Yeah, no, you do have to check your P's and Q's all the time, I think, still today, especially in those professions where you are so heavily looked at in the, mm-hmm, arts, more so than other professions where you can kind of bleed into the background. But I agree that you know, a stark switch that gets clicked off with men, and for us, it's a 24-hour experience of being a lady sometimes.
Yeah,
so.
I never thought about it like that. That's horrible.
Yeah. Horrible.
Now, what was your question?
What pushes
you
through?
What keeps you going?
You know, what?
Oh. You.
Oh.
I love this. This is great.
It's like a hot potato.
It's a difficult question. What keeps me going? I don't really sleep, so I don't really know like what it is to stop to say I keep going. You know,
so
I don't stop.
Teach me how to do that.
I want to learn her ways.
I mean, it's nonstop. Like, and when I do take a nap, if my phone is emails, and it, mm-hmm, so it's like I don't really stop to say I keep going. I just kind of go.
Yeah.
So I don't really know. I guess one, loving my job. That's one. I absolutely, yeah, love my job. I'm sometimes aggravated with it, but I love it.
Yeah.
And back to helping people. I love to help people. I love to create this creative space for people. And it's so weird. I'm really inspired by the ladies because watching, I'm like, wow. Because I don't really have the chance to see independence at all. Because when I started, I kind of started with Timbaland. And from there, it was Justin and Beyonce. So I'm really starting to appreciate like independent projects even more. And the first time, I think I told you, when I saw Tank, I was like, I was so amazed because I love how she's so out of the box.
Yep.
And I'm hoping she don't allow them to put her in the box because that's the protocol. But I don't do it. But and that, those kind of things at this point is what keeps me going. Like seeing a project like yours and like seeing you on stage. It's like, it's so much more to this industry than what I know, and I want to get out and see it all. Yeah. So I have to keep going.
Yeah.
So that's what keeps me going.
I like that.
I just want to learn from Cheryl. Okay. How to be.
Is that what keeps you
going? Jesus. What keeps me going? What keeps me going is to not go back to IHOP. Mm-hmm. I went there. I worked there and I went back twice. Don't get me wrong. I actually am someone that when I worked at IHOP, I love serving people. I have a great big smile on my face for you. I want you to have a great service and I like that quick tip right afterwards. But there were days when it just wasn't worth it.
I love
you know, where the filling up the syrup and chugging a big old thing of ice and putting it in there, or running back and forth for a lady for hours and she would leave out and don't give you anything. You know, those and to actually get paid $2 an hour, that's when it's not worth it. And whenever I get too tired, because my manager reminds me of you, she's so driven and she's the most positive thing I've ever met in the world. And she don't sleep, you know? And I think about the work that she puts in, and I think, I can't allow her to work harder than me for my dream.
Right.
And then part two, I won't go back to the IHOP, so bitch, get up. So I say, get up and do this. You know, like, you don't, would you rather be here or there? And that's your options. What's up? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah, being responsible for that choice every day, I think.
Yeah,
it's
an active choice. I have that choice.
Yeah. And it's you know, manageable bites too. Just doing and taking little steps every day is something that keeps me in check as far as like I got the vision all the way down the tunnel. Mm-hmm. But am I taking the little steps forward every day and am I living up to that passion? And I love that you said you see your manager working so hard and you say, how could somebody else work harder than me? And that you're kind of racing. I love that. That's
she
great.
She always beat me, though. Don't sleep. That's crazy.
Well, I do want to give a chance. We have a lot of...
No.
Did I know her?
No. She's not going to get you.
Look at you.
Let her rip.
Actually, mine's the same way. I always say, well, if I completely fail, I can always go back to bartending. It's actually exactly the same, which at this point, it's like, it's moved beyond that. But I feel that I have the worst boss in the world, which is, you know, me, obviously. It's like a wake up, it's like I'm so tired, and I wake up, oh, that email, and then they start doing it, like, I haven't even gotten out of bed yet, I'm still sending emails. But I think, I mean, there's nothing better than working in a creative field, or you know, of being creatively satisfied, you know, that's for me better than anything in the world. And I felt like even when I was making the James Booker film, I felt like I could die at any point and like with no regrets, because there's nothing in the world I would rather be doing than exactly what I was doing. And like with Buck Jumping, you know, it's like meeting these people, every one of whom should be their own, you know, reality show. Every one of whom deserves, you know, their own film. You know, passionate, soulful people who are endlessly inspiring, and that they allow me to come in and film, that's incredible. And then, you know, it's like to also, you know, some of the clips that y'all saw in the trailer were then in the Beyonce film, and like seeing their faces light up when I told them, you know, it's like to be able to, you know, give back a little bit, you know, of the joy that they've given me. You know, it's just meeting people like this. You know, I feel like I get to meet the best people on the planet. And if I can actually manage to pay my rent too, then like I have no complaints. Please? You know?
After looking at that, it's like there is no turning back for a soul like this.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Well, it's really true. Incredible. I think all of you followed a passion, and the money and the living and the ability to pay rent and mortgages was a subset of that passion. You know?
It's just not the priority. And for some people it is, and that's fine, but it's just not for me.
Yeah, and I think that that's another choice that people can make in a crossroads. So it's true, you do have to live.
We have to live, and we have to live fully.
Yes.
When you leave this earth, you do not want to have, at least me, I don't want to have anything in my hands. Mm-hmm. I want to have given it all. Mm-hmm. You know, that's when I've known that I have truly lived fully. Yeah. You don't want to still have talents in you.
Yeah, let it out.
No, you got to
let it out.
Nothing.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. So we have a lot of great students in the audience. There's a couple here from a group that was just newly formed called Industry Queens. And so I'm hoping that they will maybe ask a couple of questions being so passionate about this particular topic. And I want to open it up to the audience because I've talked for quite some time. And I'd love to hear audience questions.
I'm just gonna let this roll off my tongue. Okay, so we have Industry Queens and we're trying to network. We just started, we had our first meeting last weekend, but I'm really excited about it, and it's just a group of women who come and meet, and we just ask you, like, what do you do? Like, what's your name? What do you do? What are you working on? And then maybe we'll find a way to be involved with each other. We're hoping to spread it beyond Loyola. So thanks for being a kind of inspiration for us right now. But I have a question. I've always had a stigma towards men, and I've tried to create projects but try to involve the least amount of men possible, and I realize that's impossible. So how do you know, like, because I have, like, there's, like, sort of a trust issue, right? So, like, how do you know that you're comfortable with talking to people? How do you know that you're willing to, like, think that you're not just worthy, but that you can learn from other people, and then you start working for them, and then you become independent and you start doing your own projects? So how do you feel like you can finally put a project on your back? Like, do you have an example of when you were able to sort of do something on your own rather than relying on a network or like a connection or something like that?
Like, as a leader, question.
Like, if you have, like, leadership advice.
And say the question again.
It's kind of like a hard question, but an example of when you had been relying on people prior, and then you finally took a matter into your own hands and sort of spearheaded something yourself.
But I'm just kind of naive, and I was bartending. I was like, I heard James Booker on the jukebox. I'm like, I'm gonna make a film about Booker. And that was how I started making a film about Booker. I didn't go to film school. I didn't know anyone in New Orleans. I didn't own a camera. I didn't have any money. I had no idea what I was doing. I'm just going to do it. And started talking to people and calling. And, you know, I think at that point, sort of like, how do you become a producer? You just start calling yourself producer. Like, hi, I'm a producer. Like, hi, I'm a director. And I'm making a film about James Booker. And sort of like, fake it till you make it, you know. Obviously it's going to happen. I said it's going to happen. So.
Yeah. You're right.
No permeable part of that. Like, there was no doubt in your mind that you were going to do it. You had complete self-assurance that you would.
It's maybe easier when there is, like, no indication in the universe that you could actually pull it off, because then you have to believe in it wholeheartedly. Because I feel like no one can believe in it. I have to believe in it more than anybody. You know, it's like I have to believe in it, you know, 110%. Because if I can't believe in it, how would anyone else believe it? Like, if I don't believe I'm going to be able to pull off a film about James Booker, how could I ask you for an interview? You know, right. It's like you just have to, you have to know. And again, it's like I had nothing. And it also took me 6 years. You just fake it till you make it. And just be confident. And also, I mean, the fact that, like, you're young and starting out can really be an asset, you know, because I think that older people, I mean, older than you, which I now qualify as, like, they want to help people starting out. So I feel like when I was young, I was always, you know, like, they're not going to trust me or believe in me because I have no experience. But at the same time, older people no, you don't have experience, because they remember a time that they didn't have experience. And I think that, if anything, you can use that as an asset to sort of get your foot in the door. I think if you can exude, you know, like calmness or like confidence, you know, that's like half the battle right there. Again, you have to believe in yourself, but then you will like magnetically attract other people who want to see you succeed.
Yep, that's definitely.
And some of them might have penises, so don't be scared.
Don't be scared okay. at all.
Yeah, it's the truth.
Yeah. I say the same thing. I was just telling her earlier that as far as taking things into your own hands, you know, everyone told us that after we did our first Jazz Fest that they were going to be flying us overseas. Oh, girl, you're just going to fly. Ooh, it's going to be so exciting. As soon as you do your first Jazz Fest. Your first Jazz Fest. I did 2 Jazz Fests.
Where's my
Nobody tried to fly us nowhere. So we had to take that upon ourselves. We want to get overseas. We got to get there. Let's raise this money. Let's sell fish plates and oysters and fried chicken and crawfish. And let's get local bands that we love to perform at parties in our backyard, like where we rehearse at. Let's invite people into our space and let's get where we want to go. The next one?
I know. I'm
yeah, yeah. We will be there.
I need to be there. You got to send out the invite,
like,
man.
May?
When is it?
I think it's in May. May 23rd?
We'll be there. We'll be there.
April 23rd.
We right. call them Tank and the Bangers Backyard Hangouts. Yeah. And we had about 3 or 4 of them to get us overseas. And all our gig money and all of our parties, we just kept going towards, you know, we went towards that. And nobody was mad about it or had any ways, because if we want to get there, this is where this money has to go. It's about taking it into your own hands, because... And also having other hands with you, you know, that believe in the same thing.
But there will be hands
right?
there.
Yeah, there will be hands there when you call it out there. We didn't know how we was going to get there, but we got there and we lived there for 3 months.
That's amazing. Yeah, I actually got up on a stage immediately after you did at Mid-City Masquerade. And I had to perform after you, and that was like the biggest shoes I've had to have.
Oh, that's cool. That was a cool party. I love Sweet Crew. That's my favorite New Orleans.
You just told me that.
So,
thank
good
you.
Good luck to you. So exciting things are happening for you.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Michaela. I'm a freshman film major here at Loyola. And my question to you is that if you're comfortable about talking about it, what was your hardest experience being a woman in a male-dominated industry, and how did you get through it?
I have to think, so I'm...
Yeah, but we answered the last
one. Oh, you did. You did. The toughest. The toughest. The funny thing is, my breakthrough into the industry was actually a guy trying to talk to me who had no chance. Good thing I didn't let him know that, but he tried to talk to me, and he was a producer. And I was, after the storm, it just so happened, I was here during the storm, but after the storm, I just so happened to have the jeans on that he slid his number in my back pocket. I hadn't worn them, and I had them on that day when I got to Texas. And I called him. He was a producer, and that's how we got the Xbox placement. This guy who tried to talk to me. And it was really tough me having to call this man who I knew all he wanted was one thing.
Yep.
He didn't believe in my talent. I didn't know his talent. So having to go to his apartment alone as a woman, knowing what he was thinking... It ended up great. I mean, that's why I'm here today, but it was one of the toughest things I had to do. Still today, he harassed me, but we started out and it was very tough. And another experience is when I first started working with Timbaland, for some reason I would feel very like, when I had to talk to him, I became timid, and I'm far from timid. And Ty realized that he respected my talent, like she said, more than I respected my talent. So I was like, I have to fake this till I make it. Even if I don't know, I'm going to pretend like I know. And I just, I had to build his confidence. And when I started talking to him with confidence, it was very hard, very stressful. Like, to sit in the room with Timbaland and Justin Timberlake, I mean, all of this experience. I'm fairly young, really no experience. And when I was able to break through that fear, it was the best thing ever. So. I like overcame fear, and I became who I am today because of that. Mm. So I think that was the toughest for me.
Those are good.
Oh, what about you?
Oh boy!
Oh, wow!
Come on! Yeah, I can't believe that just happened. So it's never been for my cards that I've been in a mostly female-dominated industry. I worked in Western PA, there was a celebrity presenting series, and I was the stagehand, the booker, the yelling maniac of getting, you know, big acts, like big classical type acts, Trans-Siberian Orchestra. Tony Danza had to learn how to tie a bow tie for Tony. Anne Murray, like old people stuff. But I was 21, 22, and I was working with, Pennsylvania is not a, it's a union place, and I was working with a union out of Youngstown, Ohio, and they're putting up trusses, and they're, you know, using the crescent wrenches, and, you know, throwing stuff at me on purpose, like, just like, here, girl, take this, and I think some of my students today saw me pick up a giant speaker in these heels, because, like, that's the training I've had, is the expectation with men in the industry, in, you know, backstage, on stage, in front of the stage, thinking about the stage, that kind of thing, of always, no, I'm going to do this just like you do this, because we're all humans here.
Equal.
And so I think some of the hardest, the training ground for that was those moments. And yeah, as an artist myself, having people try to take advantage of that art to get other stuff. I will let him remain nameless, but there is a gentleman that has a little mark on his little being in my mind. I got his number up here, just because of the way he saw what I represented in the world, as opposed to, like, I'm here to make music and I'm here to bring a craft and an experience to these people. So, yeah, from even the business standpoint, from the backstage and the artist stage, it has been just little reminders of that constant struggle, I think, and that was a couple of my experiences of just like, okay, that happened. Can't flip out about it, mm-hmm. but let's just muscle up and do what we know we're capable of doing. Mm-hmm. So, how about you?
There's 100,000 examples of the, you know, the dude who just wants the number, and then often, you know, turning it around, it's like, whatever, making it into a positive. But I think probably the hardest one for me was one of those, and it's like we were friends, and he was going to help out the film, and he did help out the film, but then, like, he just, along the way, became one of those, like, there's an X on your name, mm-hmm. and I would be happy to never see you again. Oh, but you just brought me an international distribution deal for the film. Like, are you kidding me? So, I guess I do have to see you again, and, all right, I can't say no to it because it's for the film, which is my child, and it has to excel, but because it came from you, I will always think about that, and you're going to get a percentage of it, so then you're going to get money off of my film. But that little X is still next to your name. That's, for me, the hardest.
Yeah, so. Finding that balance. And I think, like I said, I was 21, 22. And there was a moment in those 2 years where I thought, I'm an adult now. Because I realized there's no black and white of good people are going to only ever do good mm-hmm. things. Bad people are only mm-hmm. going to ever do bad things. Mm-hmm. I'm on this side and I'll never have to interact with those folks. It's not like that at all. So,
and in the city that's so small, you will interact with them.
Absolutely. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. So figuring out that balance of getting the work done, because, again, that's what we do, right? We create and we move forward in everyone's profession, and getting that done and making sure that that's the priority and that that's why you're doing it, and that, you know, this person that is less than savory, we will say, was a role in that kind of fades away.
But I think for me, you know, in the film world here, like, I'm part of several groups of intentionally women-led organizations, so WIFT, Women in Film and Television, and Femme Fatales, which is a monthly gathering of directors and writers. And that's been huge for me, of just, like, sort of like this, to sit with other professional women and talk, you know, and, like, share stories, you know, support each other professionally and hear these stories, because mm-hmm. I felt like until then I felt very isolated.
Yeah.
And so through the process of hearing stories, sort of, like, you know, collectively sharing them like this, but then also sharing them with, like, like male allies, you know, because there are lots of wonderful men that I work with that then I feel so supported and I feel, you know, very empowered. Like with this dude in the distribution deal, like I asked my dude friends just as much, like, what should I do?
Yeah.
You know, and so that really, I mean, so it's an unfortunate situation, but I knew that I wasn't facing it alone. And I think that that's a big way that I face things, you know.
Creating that community. And that was one of the things when I reached out to the ladies and said, do you wanna come on stage and join me to talk about this for a night? I said, you know, it's not a man bashing, you know, girls rule, boys drool kind of theme. But they do, you know, but that's
sorry, what guys.
but it, you know, accessing those allies and teaching people, like, sometimes I think that there are women and men that walk around and don't see the impact of their foregone conclusions about the role of women. They don't see when they doubly question Hillary about those Benghazi emails and let Trump just run his mouth in their home.
Muslims.
You know, they're watching the TV and they're letting that happen. They don't think as deeply. So I think creating that community of not only awareness of the past, but, you know, let's move forward and kind of skew that lens a little bit to show the real impact of what your foregone conclusions are. And I think that again, also, for me personally, mitigates some of those terrible, terrible behaviors of people, both men and women, in my past. So I think that's what you stand on from there. How about you? You got a story?
No.
No. Blessed life over there.
Blessed, yes. As a matter of fact, it is quite. And I need the question again, honestly.
The question was, if you're comfortable sharing it, what was your hardest experience being in a male-dominated industry, and how did you get through that hard experience?
I don't even feel like I'm injected in the industry in such a way where I feel such pressure on myself. The only, I'm such in my own little world and reality of Bangerville, as people like to call it, as to where the only time I feel bum rushed to or truly film is when all my boys are tripping on my Android phone because they got iPhones. You know, they be tripping on me. And, you know, and they act like they're in their own special little club, and everything that I do with myself and my phone is lame. Like, and they like to come against me a lot sometimes, and I guess it can become a bit irritating and overwhelming when someone in my group may think that my decisions are based truly off of just my emotions and not my own very thought process, as if I'm that confusing, as if my planet is that far away from yours. You know, that's when it's irritating. And as a woman, I truly feel alone.
Well, that instinct to women act on emotions only. Men, I see them act on emotions every day. We all do it.
If you guys could spend one day in the studio with us. Some of the most emotional creatures in the world.
They are.
Yes. Like, are we serious?
We all do it. That's fine. Like, you do it, I do it. That's great. Let's all just admit it and then move forward,
nope,
right?
They will never admit it.
No. Men are on their periods all the time.
All the time. Yeah. All the
it's a reverse, though. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a reverse.
But that's their expectation, you know? I could just as much sympathize with them in a role that they are expected to play as well. When we're talking about our, you know, prim and pretty role as women, they're expected to be stoic and not act on emotions in the same way that we're, you know, foregone conclusion, gonna wild out in some way because we're ladies. But yeah, I think coming to those, just admitting those things is where the equality is. Oh,
yes, that's where it lies.
Yeah.
We're the same.
Yeah, the same.
Don't try to, yeah. The same.
My eyelashes might be nicer, but like that's it, yeah. Other questions? I see a hand.
Kind of like two questions. So one question would be, you brought up that what you see with female artists, the first question that always gets asked is, what does she look like? Mm-hmm. So my question is, like, how do you respond to that without, like, do you go into the, like, do you say what she looks like, or do you kind of just ignore that the question even happened? And then my next question is, I did an internship recently, and it was kind of like very hands-on manual lifting things. And I noticed that, like, one of the women, she would often say, like, oh, I need a strong boy to come help me, or, like, I need, and I'm kind of a smart mouth with things like that. So, like, especially in a professional setting, like, how do you addressed that what they said was wrong without, you know, like stepping on toes kind of thing.
Oh, the stepping on toes is really tricky because it is still business and you do want to succeed. So it's just dependent on, in a lot of rooms at this point, because of my resume, I can be a smart ass. I'm sorry. And I kind of say whatever I want to say. So it's just dependent on, like, if I'm in a room with Clive Davis and he says, how does she look? I'm going to entertain the question. Oh, she's beautiful. But let's get to her talent. It's just dependent on the room. It's dependent on the artist. Like, I think if I was representing somebody like Tank, I could talk. I could say whatever I want to say because she's going to come in and it's going to be so powerful. It's like, nah. You know, so it's just really depending on the brand that I'm representing and who I'm speaking to. I would prefer not to address the question, but then sometimes I have to be smart for my artist. So then I have to say, she's beautiful. What's next? You know? I don't like it all the time, but it's still business and we still need to climb those steps, you know, to get to the top. So you kind of have to pick and choose. You really have to pick and choose, and it's very important. Because a lot of the female artists I work with fuss with me sometimes because I'm kind of devil's advocate. Like, I know how to play a room. Unfortunately, I have to play it, but play it. I mean, look, Hillary is where she is today because she understands the concept of playing a room. So it's very important. So like you said, you have a smart mouth sometimes. Sometimes you may have to dumb it down just a little. And then when you get the check, it's like, then be smart. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, kind of thing. So it's hard not to like be like, well, anybody can lift a box.
Right.
Yes. See, I can't answer that question because I'm the type to look for the big strong man lift the box for me. I don't want to lift the box. It's heavy. And you, hey, at the end of the day, your arms are bigger than mine. And I would appreciate it. So I would probably be the one you mumbling your breath.
Right.
I said it. I'm looking for him. That's me. I'm sorry. Change the tire too while you're at it.
I saw a couple other hands. Yeah, Miss Abby.
Yeah, okay, so I have a couple of questions. My first question is, what are some daily rituals that each of you have, or maybe just some frequent rituals that you kind of put into your life that help you just sort of balance everything that's going on for each of you in terms of just how hard you hustle on a daily basis and how many opportunities there are coming in. Just managing that and making sure that you're operating at your highest at all times.
That's a good question.
Yeah, I'm still working on that.
Oh.
Every day.
Every day. I'm still trying to learn how to stop working at a reasonable hour.
It's tough.
Yeah.
And as of lately, I think I've been reminding myself to meditate every morning because I'm so used to jumping up, grabbing my phone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, okay, hold on. Phone your second. Self first.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I have to remind myself of this because, you know, as a manager, I have clients and they don't really care, you know? So it's very important to take time for yourself for a second, and you have to remind yourself in this business because it was not a 9-to-5. You're not like work clocking in anywhere. Like she said, there's no clock out. So like right now, I'm sure my inbox is blowing up and I have to remind myself, you are on a panel, do not look at your phone.
I feel the same.
Yeah, so it's like, you almost have to remind yourself and when I first started, I literally didn't stop. No meditation, I never stopped. Just recently, I picked up two new clients, the Les Twins. They started out with Beyonce dancers. They do not stop. And it's like I have to tell them, give me a minute and let me breathe. I'll be back in 10 minutes. And it's very important, because if not, you'll lose yourself. I have to at this point. Not always, but at this point, there's rules. I have to. And you have to kind of make people follow and respect your space, because they won't.
Mm-hmm.
It's very important.
I think when you're starting out, it's like hustle, because you're climbing. But then, like, it comes a point, and you'll know it, because it's like, I could not fit one more thing in my day.
Exactly.
And that's when you need to, like, you know, pull back, which is a good problem to have, you know.
Yeah, it's a great problem.
But, yeah, like, take a vitamin in the morning. That's as far as I've gotten.
Drink some water. I don't know.
Water. Water's good.
I'm not them at all. I'm not.
Teach us how to be healthy.
I am a true believer in it's time to lay on down now. It's time to go to my favorite restaurant. It's time to watch my favorite show that I've been waiting to watch. I feel as though I need that time. As a, I'm very human first. I'm human first. You know, and I have to take care of me.
Teach us.
And I have to.
Please teach
and
us.
I have to spoil Tank. Tank has to be spoiled.
Watch
you know, Tank
all
has
night.
To eat out 3 times a week. You know, I'm just getting into The Secret. I don't know if you ever saw that that documentary, The Secret. You know, calling things out of there, and so that's what I'm trying to do now to really get away from negative talking. It actually is a chore.
Yeah, it is.
To not sip tea, to not constantly flick through Facebook and Instagram all day judging people and yourself.
Yeah.
You know, that is really a chore to put it in your mind. I'm about to have a positive life. I'm about to speak positive things into existence, not only for myself, my family, but my friends. But when it's starting with yourself first, you see how hard it is. But once it becomes repetition and habit, then it's better. So that's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah,
I like that.
Yeah, nice. Mm-hmm. And when you do workshops, you can teach us how to be professional. You can teach us how to take care of ourselves.
I'll teach you how to lift heavy things. That'll be great.
And I'll teach you how to drive a manual.
That'd be great. I love this. We're forming a coalition. This is great.
I was just wondering what the most positive experience you've had as a woman in the music industry.
Countless.
You have to.
I don't know, every day.
Every day is positive.
Positive woman. Getting asked on this panel.
Oh, I love that.
That's good answer. Yeah.
Winning points right there.
Good answer.
You're next.
That was a good answer.
I'm still thinking. I'm just buying time for us.
Most positive moment? That's tough. What do you
woman.
Consider a positive
as a woman?
What most positive moment in your... You're actually a part of this. So what
puts you on the spot here.
Oh, that's
here.
Right. Yeah, you get to answer the question.
Well, I love working with students. I mean, just a lot of my students that work here came tonight and just seeing them succeed, I think that's really exciting.
I love my crew. You know, I love seeing them succeed. Like, one of my, I have two DPs, director of photographies, and both of them are artists in their own rights. And one of them, you know, she's directed music videos forever. And I'm terrible at music videos. So, like, I love, you know, going on and, you know, like, going on her sets and helping her organize. I love producing for her. I love seeing her succeed. I've told her when she makes her first film, you know, I'll happily produce it. And the same, you know, with Zach, you know, it's like anytime you need anything, you know, I'm here for you because they give so much for me. And I feel like, again, I can't, you know, the maternal in me, I can't help but think of it as a little family. It's, you know, it's like we can support each other in our projects. You know, so in addition to, you know, like just come over to my house and eat dinner, you know, like, you know, I'll cook lunch for them, you know, like bring it into the studio and then just sitting down and like, you know, how are you, obviously it's always, you know, frame rates and hard drives and what kind of camera and or the color, you know, blah, 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 that's my whole day. But then, you know, for that moment at lunch sitting down and like, how's your script? How's that edit coming? Oh, that dude's not calling you back. Do you want me to call him for you? You know, so sort of, I think that way, again, sort of making sure that I'm nurturing and nourishing their creativity as much as I feel like, you know, that people help me. I don't know if that's as a woman, but that's one of my favorite parts of what I do.
The question is as a woman?
That's what she asked.
Most positive.
Well, you are a woman, so it would be as a woman.
As crazy as this may sound, I think out of all the things I accomplished, my most positive... it is a part of my career is when I was able to buy my mom a car and my brothers didn't do it first.
Yeah.
So I was able to say, yeah. Your daughter. Yeah. That was one of my most positive moments.
Wow. I would say, if I had to say one, and I literally was sitting here just twisting my head, just really thinking of it, and then a voice in the back of my head kept saying, let that answer come naturally, Tank. Like, what's really the most positive thing that you feel like you've done in your life? as a woman. And as a woman, it would be my decision of celibacy and abstinence in my life, that it was truly a choice, you know, that I would actively make, you know, for my life and who I wanted to love and be loved by. And, you know, it just felt like such a choice and such a positive choice for me, because it's just mine. This is me. It's my house. And I decide who comes in it.
Yeah.
And that's positive and that's important to me, and it had been for a very long time.
So I want to jump in just because it happened this year, and I'm still so... I called my mom about this. My students, the industry queens, we were standing in the quad, and they told me about this idea that they had for this network of women, because they realized this need for community, and they realized that nobody does anything alone. Mm-hmm. And they said, do you want to be a part of it?
Oh.
That was my moment. Like, honestly, that, like, right after, swear to God, you too. I called my mom in the parking garage. I was like, guess what just happened? And she is like, she has taught me how to be, you know, she's the OG of badass ladies. So, yeah. You know, I called her to tell her, like, you did right. And I know that for them to be able to see that in 2016, to see that there is maybe a discrepancy and to want to solve it, to not either throw their hands up or, you know, get violent about it, but to want to solve it together.
Yeah.
That's where it was for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. We have other questions? Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
I was just wondering, as like musicians, like which women artists influenced you and or do you like the most? What helped you like think, oh, I want to do this, or
Nina Simone? That's a bad girl.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's a bad girl. She gets this spirit in her. You know, she just get off stage. She really is powerful. She sacrificed a lot for music, for the movement that was going on at the time. And she would say it herself. She'll say, I had a lot of life going on in me. And, you know, I made a lot of sacrifices for relationship, love, my children. But it all was worth it for the music. You know, she literally say that she gave her life to this thing. Yeah. This thing that can pass on by that keeps going while she's gone, you know. Mm-hmm. So she was huge for me. Nina's is amazing. And I hate when people say, is that a man? You know, so beauty to me, voice, strength, absolutely lovely. Yes, I love Nina.
Lily, what about music or filmmakers?
He said musicians. I'm off the hook.
Oh. We'll take filmmakers here, too.
Filmmakers.
You first.
Is the question, who am I inspired by? Female artists?
Female artists you like or inspire you? Or...
And it's making me think about one of the greatest moments of my career. It's funny you asked that. Celine Dion. I'm very inspired by Celine.
Wow.
And one of the greatest moments of my career is when she asked me to work with her. So it's funny because
that's awesome.
It's kind of a double fold question. But I'm also, like, locally, you may be familiar, Bridget Bazile. I'm absolutely, mm-hmm. For some reason, Bridget is like, I could work with anybody in the world, but when I'm in Bridget's presence, I'm like, So I think if we're talking industry, as of lately, Adele. I'm very, very inspired by Adele as well.
I like Adele. I like that Adele was fat. I like that.
That's one of the things I used to
My sister literally said, how come this fat girl? That's what she told me. And
she broke through.
But she said that because you don't see it too often on TV, man. Let's count the ladies, man, really.
Yeah.
And for her to be beautiful and have this voice and mm-hmm. and be walking like that and chasing pavements, I was truly moved.
Yeah.
Damn, man.
Yeah.
Musicians first.
So
ladies first.
I gotta be honest. At 10, Jagged Little Pill came out. Yeah. And I learned women could yell about stuff. And women could take it out on Dave Coulier or whoever that album was mm-hmm. about. And Alanis had a voice. She had something to say, and she was just and she has since, you know, remolded her career a million times over to not be that always angry woman. Yeah. But for a 10-year-old in rural Western PA that, you know, just making my way in the world, for that to hit, I was like, oh, I can say things. Okay. I will say things from henceforth about how I feel about this and how I'm treated in the world and how the world is going and how we're all spinning around and how we're connected. And that was outrageous to me. That blew my mind that a woman could say, like, screw you for this.
Yeah.
Or I want this. Or I'm gonna do this. That was so cool.
I think for me, the female filmmaker that's influenced me the most is someone that none of you all ever heard of, Mimi Pickering.
You know who that is?
You know Mimi.
Strike it from the record. Mimi, your biggest fans
Mimi,
are here.
Of course, Mimi.
She lives in Kentucky.
Okay.
And she, I interned for her. That was my beginning in filmmaking, as I had sent a letter to Apple Shop saying, hey, I'm young, and I'm an intern. She said she'd never had an intern in like 30 years, but something about my letter. I was like, really? And I think I didn't necessarily learn a lot about like the actual like mechanics of filmmaking, but seeing how she integrated films and her life and did it in a very responsible way, very responsible to the community, made films that were really, you know, really impacting. My dad's family's from Pennsylvania, so coal miners, and seeing like the early films she made around coal are just like badass films. And, you know, like to be doing that in the 70s. And again, you know, she's in Kentucky, you know? So I think just sort of, I felt like from her I learned how to be a filmmaker and how to be, I don't know, responsible and also just to not be scared. And then her collection of films were also super cool.
Mimi.
Yeah, MP.
Kentucky.
Obviously, I'll send you links.
We have other questions, I see.
Is we gonna ask another question? Okay, so my question is, when opportunities come to you that feel overwhelming, maybe especially if you have a lot on your plate at that point, and then something comes to you that just seems like, oh my God, I have to do this. This is, and maybe it's really big for you. It feels like it's out of your comfort zone. I'm wondering how each of you kind of initially react and respond to just kind of like that prompt to leave your comfort zone for like a big opportunity. And I'm also wondering, with regards to that, how do each of you kind of handle when you mess up?
We don't mess up.
No, I'm just playing. Just joking. Ask the first question again.
The first question was like, you know, when you, I guess, when you first found yourself being asked to work with Tim Blake or Justin Timberlake, what is something that feels maybe out of your comfort zone? Like, wow, how am I going to do this? What do you kind of like use to calm your mind down or just really do it, I guess?
That's a good question, because I still don't know. I guess for me, my most challenging experience was my first international, not my first, but an international artist. The language barrier, she's from China, and she's huge in China. So I'm like, how am I gonna, we're sitting at the table, and I'm clearly, I don't understand what you're saying, you don't understand me. How am I gonna get through this? I think for me, it's about bringing them into my world. You know what I mean? Kinda, I have to take control of that moment. That's how I got through that one, because it was very difficult. And then they brought me to China, which became a little bit more difficult. I was very intimidated. I didn't know how to start, how to finish, and I just kind of welcomed them into me because they called me for a reason. So now it's about me. Let's do this. You know, so now you have to use my slang. I can't speak your language, so now you're going to use my slang, and we're going to, you know, let's make this Cheryl's world for a moment, because that kind of broke the ice, and I was able to be a little bit more comfortable in the moment. But it's kind of each situation is different. Sometimes I guess it's almost like fake it till you make it again. Mm-hmm. You have to fake it till you make it. You don't really want to show the discomfort, and then you become comfortable by not showing your discomfort in a way. So I guess that
fake it till you make it, I guess, right?
I feel like everything I do is outside of my comfort level. Like, yeah. Mm-hmm. Every day is a completely different bag. Like, right. And that's what I love about my job is no 2 days are ever the same. So I'm learning things all. So things, you know, I mean, like the Beyonce thing is like, I don't know how to do this, but I feel like so long, I know that I will give 100% to anything I do. And I feel like as long as I'm giving every ounce of my energy to it and like every bit of attention to, I think that's really the bigger thing is just paying attention to it, mm-hmm. that I don't worry about it. Because for one, you know, I know that it's going to be okay. Mm-hmm. But I feel like even if I fail, I can't say like, well, you know, I was too slack on that, or, you know, it makes it less intimidating if I know that I'm able to give it my all, because then, you know, I can just dive in completely. I'm not gonna fail, but I know that even if I do, it's like it'll be an honest failure, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And just fake it till you make it.
Yeah.
And learning to say no, like learning, which is the hardest thing of all. It's like, actually, I have too much on my plate. Which especially, you know, I mean, for me, you know, if jobs come and it's like, oh, I really need the money, but I have too much, I give it to a friend, you know, so then like, you know, karmically it comes around, you know, mm-hmm. or at least that's how I operate. You know, or at least, you know, if I say no, I don't want to leave him hanging, so I'll put him in the direction, you know, sort of like graciously. I'm really bad at saying no, though.
That's still something that I would, you know, I'm scared of that big moment when, you know, I think it's too big for me, you know, because I know that it's coming. I know that it's coming because I'm working. And as what my life has taught me is that it's like this. It just keeps getting higher and higher, and each opportunity keeps getting bigger and bigger. So I know that it's coming. But a friend once said something that I teach to any student I have about defining things for yourself, and the word failure, he defined it as failure is when you talk yourself out of doing something great.
Mm.
And that's how I should live.
I like that.
Did we answer your question? I'm just curious.
Okay, cool.
I was wondering you answered it, Tank, really well with your quote about failure, but when you do mess up, I guess, like if it kind of slips, if you don't do something as well as you want it to, like you're putting in 100% and it doesn't really go correctly, do you have a way that you sort of handle that?
Just thank God for my friends. They're very encouraging. They're very inspiring. And they always remind me, live to fight another day.
Yeah.
The proof of a new day is the proof of a second chance.
Yeah.
You know, and truly living like that was the past. You really can't do anything about it. It was the past. You really have to do something that the new day has brought you. Like, because, you know, as artists, as people, we could dwell in that. You could dwell in what just happened. I had a show the other day. I was like, I don't think I gave 100. I don't think I gave 100. And somebody was like, you have to continue to go on and give 100 for the next one. Like, you can't live in that. Mm-hmm. What you look like living in yesterday? How shall you go on? You know, so, yeah, just good friends and just knowing that every day makes itself for real. Yeah. It really does.
Also acknowledging it. It's like, all right, so that show wasn't it. You know, you can think about, like, what needs to be different? Was I tired? You know, you can, like, embrace it, but you don't have to dwell on it, you know?
Yeah.
Or, like, for me, and it's still hard, but just, like, acknowledging it. Like, I can't think of it, if a shot's out of focus, that's not a very good example, you know? Or if I feel like I didn't deliver something on time. You know, it's like they wanted a DVD. I got it to them 2 weeks late. You know, like, especially when I was younger, I just try to, like, shirk it, but that doesn't go away. So I'm still learning the lesson. But if I can just, like, now almost, like, beat them to it. Like, if it's 2 weeks late, I'll be the first person to say, like, this is 2 weeks late. I'm so sorry. You know, moving forward, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. I feel like for me, it helps sort of like take off the guilt as well. You know, just like you acknowledge it and then and move on. Right. But I feel like if I try to hide from it, it doesn't go away. So when I do mess things up, I wish I could think of a really juicy example. I just find it's better for me to say it out loud and not hold on to that, you know?
I like that.
I like that too.
Okay. So I noticed that you guys seem to have like a good team around you guys, like each and everyone. So what is like a value, something that somebody must have on your team? Like, so, because you know, team building is everything, you gotta get along. So like, what's one thing that you look for with the people surrounding you that really makes it work for you?
Gotta be positive. Gotta believe in God. You have to believe in something that's bigger than this in your ego. Because we got to make this work. So you have to acknowledge a couple of things before you get up in this circle. And that's truly that this is a circle. It is small. And that you need something bigger than yourself to get out of yourself sometimes. So got to be a positive person. Have to have some type of leader of your life because we're all, you know, like, yeah, that's what it is. Get a new guitar if you believe in God. That's what we do. That's what we really do, yeah. Okay.
The application is one question long.
Right. Do you believe in God?
Do you believe? You know, you hit the on top of your head with the Bible, but I need to know, you know, you got some good balls.
Right.
Or not. Yeah. It's not all about you.
Yeah.
I definitely feel the positivity. You know, it's like you can have cranky days. You know, I want people, like, if you're feeling cranky, just be cranky. You know, just, like, be honest with your emotions. I don't care. You know, there's bigger things than your crankiness right now. Also, because I'm going to be cranky some days, you know.
I feel like
overall, I need a positive person, you know, who's, you know, I'm open with the fact that I don't know how I'm going to finish buck jumping. I don't know how it's going to get structured. I don't know how we're going to fundraise. I don't know what festivals.
It's looking pretty good.
Tonight's lesson brought to you by Fake It Till You Make It. But I feel like being surrounded by people who are willing to go on that journey together, you know, who are willing to, you know, if there's money, awesome. If there's not money, awesome. You know, we're just going to, there's bigger things, you know. Yes. Yeah. And I think that's my application. You know, if you can cook, awesome.
That's a
if
plus.
Not, do the dishes. You know?
Right.
Yes. You know? Oh, gosh.
Or, like, I need someone who's going to buy into my vision. Because, again, like, I'm also buying into theirs, you know. And I feel that's, you know, because there's going to be tough days and we're all going to be broke at the end of it. But, you know, if you can make a beautiful piece of art, then for me, it's all worth it. So I guess people who, you know.
Yeah.
You're so right.
Oh, boy. You guys are throwing me. I just walled off.
You thought this was going to be easy.
I know.
Also, I haven't forgotten you haven't answered the question.
Yeah, I'm like looking at you right now, Cheryl. No, I have to be super honest. I need people smarter than me.
Mm.
I need to keep running when I'm in a situation that I know I'm probably the most, you know, cerebrally present person in the room. That is no fun for me.
That's
because it means everybody is so smart. Every single human is so smart. Everyone has their talents to tap into. That's what I mean by smart. Like, have you actualized your gifts? I need to see that from my team or the people around me or my classroom, and that's what keeps me supported and keeps me running, because I always love a challenge and always love keeping up with, you know, somebody who's playing the accordion, and that's nothing that I want to do as a musician, but like, man, you really killed it on that squeeze box. So like, now I want to figure out how to equal that vocally or songwriting or something like that. So I think having somebody better than me at something around at all times.
I like that. Challenges. They keep you on your toes. Challenges you. I like that.
Because I don't need to sleep either. You know, like, you guys are constantly being challenged.
I'm the only person on the planet that still needs to sleep. I'm so old fashioned.
All right. I bought you time.
I mean, you guys hit it. God. I mean, just about what everybody said. For me, really, you have to work, because a lot of people want to come on board and they don't really want to do the work. You know, like, you see what we have and you see what we're doing, and we didn't just get this. Like, it's a lot of work. So you have to be willing to work, and you have to have morals. And you have to be willing to, like, it can't just be about you. It's not about you, you know what I mean? Yeah. You have to be about the team. It's no longer I, it's we. And I'm big on, as of lately, like I try to put that in my team. Like, nah, we in this together. If you mess up, I mess up. You know, if you don't have, I need to feed you, because when I'm hungry, you need to feed me. Mm-hmm. And that's just the type of people that I want around me at this point as far as my team is concerned.
I love all that. That's excellent.
Yeah.
It's sort of like, it's harder, but it's easier too.
Yeah, you know? It is.
Like-minded people are it's good to have around.
It is good. Very good.
Yeah.
Smart, like
smart.
Who don't need to sleep.
Right. Who don't need to sleep.
Yeah. Those are all, check those out. Yeah. Well, ladies, I think that I'm so, so grateful, not only for the things that you've accomplished, but for the things that you've shared and the community that we've kind of all created here in this moment tonight. So I really want to thank you. I want to thank Reed Wick from the Grammy U organization for connecting me.
Reed is amazing.
Really?
Right?
He's awesome.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, it's so weird looking at him because we've been emailing each other for 2 years, Reed.
We finally met tonight.
He's amazing. I love it.
Where y'all going?
She said, "See you."
I'm on the panel. Where's mine?
Let's talk about that in a minute. just hold that thought. But no, I want us to all thank these women for taking the time out of their Tuesday night. So make sure you thank that woman sitting right there for spearheading this. All of these wonderful events that are coming up. If we can put that first graphic back up, you can check it out. It's also in your programs. There's music, there's film, there's academic talks, there's brown bag lunches. You can get your feminism on in the next week. Please do. Thank you for coming.